blueprints for success. Biblical blueprints for success. Hallelujah. And I pray that these words will lead to success in your life in the name of Jesus. Amen. And so, from last time, what was the main thing that we learned last time that can help us succeed? What was it? Wisdom. Ecclesiastes tells us that wisdom brings what? Success. And one of the factors or element of wisdom we learned was what? Skills. Praise the Lord. Wisdom says if your axe is dull and you do not sharpen it, what would happen? You will need to use more strength. But wisdom brings success. And I share with us that our axe stands for a tool that you use to work. So whatever area of work you are in, the skills that you use, that's your axe, right? In your family, your communication skill, your relational skill, all those interpersonal skills, those are your axes. If you have not refined them, you may not have great success in your family, right? And so we learned last time that every one of us, we cannot carry old tools. We cannot carry tools that we are not sharpening. If we want to have speed and success, in fact, sometimes part of increasing our skill might be maybe more education, maybe expanding what we know. So we are not in the same place for 5 or 10 years. So wisdom leads to success. And one of the things about wisdom is our skills must be up to date. Our skills must be refined so we can progress. But today I want to move on to another element of wisdom. Praise the Lord. Another factor in wisdom is planning. Can we all say that together? Planning. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 1. We are going to read what the scripture says right here. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 1. Talking about planning, it says, "The plans of the heart belong to man, but the answer of the tongue is from the Lord." I'm going to read that again. "The plans of the heart belong to man, but the answer of the tongue is from the Lord." It means that answer of prayer belongs to God. But planning is not God's responsibility. It belongs to man. Literally, that verse in the Hebrew language says, to man belongs planning. But the answer of the tongue is from the Lord. What that is saying is that if you're going to succeed in every area of your life, maybe your career or your business or your family or your personal life, guess what you're going to need? You are going to need more than prayer. Because God answers prayer, but God doesn't plan for anybody. That's what Proverbs chapter 16 verse 1 is saying. Lord, bless my business. God says, I'm going to bless it, but where is the plan? God, bless my family. God says, I'm going to bless it, but where is the plan to make sure that your family succeed? Answer of prayer belongs to God, but are you a planner? A lot of endeavors do not succeed, not because God doesn't want them to succeed, because they are started without any plan. Praise the Lord. And so what we are learning today is that if you want to succeed, you must be a planner. Let's look at what Jesus says on planning. Luke chapter 14, verse 28 to 32. Luke chapter 14, verse 28 to 32. You can open your scriptures there. Luke 14, 28 to 32. And I'm going to read to you what Jesus says right here. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it? Lest, after he has laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish it. Verse 31. Or, what king goes to make war against another king does not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to meet him who comes against him with 20,000? Or else, while the other is still a great way off, he sends a delegation and asks conditions of peace. You know what Jesus is saying? Whether it's about building or about fighting a war, Jesus is saying he expects you to plan if you are going to succeed. Jesus says, there is no man that wants to build a tower. The tower can be your career. The tower can be your business. The tower can even be your family. The tower can be anything. Jesus says he expects us to first of all sit down and say, do I have enough to successfully complete this project? So my question is, those things you have started in your life before now, or maybe which you are doing right now, did you have solid plans with pen and paper written out and say, these are my projections, this is how this is going to go, by this time this is what I'm going to do? If you don't, if you just started, Jesus says you can get half of the way and you discover you don't have enough to finish it, and when you fail, everybody will laugh and say, well, look at that guy. He started a business and he closed down in 6 months. Planning. Jesus expects us to plan if we are going to succeed. Praise the Lord. A lesson from the ant on planning. The scripture tells us that we can learn from ants when it comes to planning. Now, turn your scriptures to Proverbs chapter 30, verse 24. Proverbs chapter 30, verse 24. Let's see what the scripture says. There are four things which are little on the earth, but they are exceedingly wise. The ants are a people not strong, yet they prepare their food where? When? In the summer. Did you catch that? I'll read it again. The scripture says there are four things which are little. They are tiny little creatures. But they are what? They are very wise. They are often wiser than us big creatures. One of them is the ants. They are not a people strong. That means they are. Do you all know what ants are? You can crush 100, even 1,000 ants with 1 foot. That's how tiny they are. But God says with their little brain, they are wise. You know how? They prepare their food in the summer. Proverbs 6, verse 6 to 8. Proverbs 6, verse 6 to 8. Another reference to the ant. Go to the ant, you sluggard, consider her ways and be wise. Which, having no captain, overseer, or ruler, provides her supplies in the summer and gather her food in the harvest. Here is what the scripture is saying. The ants are wise because they are aware of the different seasons of the year, particularly the summer and the winter. So what they do is that the ants, particularly the ones that live, you know, in Palestine and other areas that are not so cold, there are ants that live in the cold areas, and somebody has said, you know, they go to hibernation, but not all ants. These ants, when it is summertime, you will see them carrying their little food. They will be picking from everywhere, and they will take them to some kind of storage place. Why? Because they know when winter comes, number one, the food will not be available. The leaves are dry and everything is dry. Number two, they cannot move around. And so, you know what God calls that? He says the ants plan for the year. So when winter comes, they have plenty of food to eat, even though they are not working, because they can't. You know why? Last summer, they were working against the next winter. That is planning. Praise the Lord. It means that they do what is fitting for the season. They do what is appropriate when food is plenty. They gather them. They store them. When the weather is conducive, they gather them and plan ahead of time. Even though they have no teacher, they have no overseer, they have no ruler. Are we that wise? Or do we live by the season and by the time? Do you know that many of us, we just live by the day. We do what we can do right now without thinking down the line. God is saying, it is hard to succeed if you don't plan way ahead of time. That means ants understand the principle of time and season in nature. And the Bible calls that wise. In fact, it says they are exceedingly wise. A life without plan will result in missed opportunities. If ants were people, they would die in the winter. Do you know that? If there were people, they would die in the winter because most people live their life for right now. So when winter comes, they realize, oh, I cannot work, really? All the foodstuff is dry, they will die. So a life without plan will be mismanagement of resources and time. It will be little productivity because there's no plan. Now, let me ask you a question. You're saying, well, okay, Pastor, I get it, but maybe I think I'm a person that is well-planned. Here are some questions I want us to consider. Why do most people work till late in the night? Why do you think most people work till late in the night, every day, 24-7? They go to work, maybe they leave work late, or they come home, they are still doing some work from their job. You know why? The reason a lot of people work till 12, till 1 a.m. sometimes is because their day was not well planned, so they have to work into the night. Not everybody. I'm not talking about people in night shift. I'm talking about people that have day shift. When your day is not well planned, you will work into the night because your day was not well spent. Why do we not get a lot done that we would love to get done? Why? Because our time is not well planned. Have you had people that say, well, I wish there were more than 24 hours in a day? Why do you think we say that? We're not going to get more than 24 hours in a day. The reason we say we wish there's more than 24 hours is because the 24 hours we have, we don't know how to manage it. And so what is supposed to be done today gets moved to tomorrow, gets moved to the day after. How are we going to succeed and be triumphant in our lives? Planning is very important. You see a lot of people, they are always in a rush. They are, you know, everything is rush, rush. Why do you think so? If you are one of those people that is always rushing, what I'm sharing with you today is, the reason you're always rushing is that you are not planning your time and your activities. Praise the Lord. As busy as Jesus was, he had 24 hours in a day. So he's not going to give you 25 hours. Praise the Lord. Amen. So if you rush every time, it's because your day, your week, your month had not been well planned, so they were not well spent. And so everything now, you have to always rush to get them done. That is one of the things that happen when we don't plan. Praise the Lord. According to the Bible, do you know how many hours that we're supposed to have in a day? I know you're saying 24 hours, but the question is not how many hours are in one day, but how many working hours, how many hours we're supposed to have in a day for the daytime. Does anybody know? Jesus tells us, John chapter 11, verse 9 to 10. John chapter 11, verse 9 to 10. Listen to what Jesus says. Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? That's Jesus. Are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of this world. But if one walks in the night, he stumbles because light is not in him. Praise the Lord. How many hours did Jesus say we're supposed to have in a day? Do you know what Jesus means by that? What Jesus means is, remember, it's not this time that everything is modernized. The daylight from perhaps 6 o'clock to sundown is 12 hours. What Jesus is saying is that you are only supposed to walk during that time. I give you 12 hours for time to rest, to plan your next day, to plan your next activity. But guess what? Let me ask you a question. How many hours are in your own day? Some people have 16 hours. Some people have 20 hours in their day. You understand? From the time they get up, they are doing one thing or the other until way into the midnight. If you are like that, that is a proof that your days are not planned. Is somebody following me? He said, no, I'm just a hard worker. I like to work for 16 hours. Jesus says, no, I'm the creator. I gave you 12 hours. But you know, with the light and computer and everything, the things we didn't get done before, we will still keep working on them until 10 p.m., until 11 p.m., until 12 p.m., until 1 a.m., until 2 a.m. When we live like that, and many people do. Many people, this word is for all of us. This is to correct all of us, okay? When you do that, you are not living the life God wants you. Your productivity cannot be what it needs to be. You may be very productive on your job, but other areas of your life will not be productive. Because you are living a life that is not in the formula of God. Jesus said, I give you 12 hours in your daytime. The other 12 hours, it doesn't mean you're going to sleep for 12 hours. Maybe you sleep for 8 hours or 7. Within those 12 hours remaining will be probably your time to pray. Will be probably your time for the family. Will be probably your time to plan your next day and your next week. But guess what? If you don't plan well, you are forced to work all day. Work doesn't mean you are on your employment. It may mean, okay, let me ask you a question. Do you know people that go to stores at night? After you have gone to work all day, that's when you remember, oh, I need to go to the store. And then after that, you go to the store. After that, you go and do this and that. By the time you come home at night, and you say, well, it's just America. Life is busy. No, it's lack of planning. Praise the Lord. Wisdom says if we want to be successful and be productive, we have to be planners of our days. We must look down into the future. We must plan our lives. Now, here are questions to help us know if you are living a planned life. Number one, do you have your life separated or delineated to different categories? In other words, your life, do you have different aspects of your life, such as time for your spiritual life, time for your family life, time for your work and career, time for your social life, time for your personal development? Do you have your life divided into those categories? If no, that means you are just leaving everything. Everything is just lumped together. That is one of the areas for planning. Because look, we are not living only for job. Praise God. But isn't that what most of us live for? All our day is for what? Work. If we live like that, how is our spiritual life going to succeed? Hello? If all your energy, your data, some people, once they wake up till evening, all that is in their mind, all that they use their energy for is what? Work. How is your spiritual life going to succeed? It's going to disappear. Number two, how is your family life going to thrive? It's not going to be there. How is your, maybe even a healthy social life, how is it going to thrive? It's not going to be there. Number four, how is your personal life? When I say personal development, maybe just to improve yourself in your knowledge, improve yourself in your skills, improve yourself in interpersonal relationship, know what is going on around you. How are you going to do that? There is no way. Why? Because you have not divided your life into different categories and have a plan and strategy to develop each of them. We are just living a life that is lumped together. You know why? Because there is no planning of our lives. Praise God. That is one of the questions. So what do we do? From this time, let's try to see, can I partition the different categories of my life and dedicate time to furnish each of them? You know, some people lose their marriages, and that is when they realize that they've been working all their lives and their homes have been neglected. They can be very good hard worker, but they fail in their marriages. Why? There is no plan for their life. All they live for is to work. There are believers that came from other parts of the world. Once they hit America, give them a few months, their spiritual life will all but disappear. Why? There's no time for it. There are people that they have no other activity done because God says, go and look at the ants. They plan everything. If you don't plan, this is what this is going to take. After that, that time is cut off. This is for this. Somewhere, something will suffer. Praise the Lord. So the first question in helping you determine if your life is planned is my life categorized into different aspects? And if it is, do I have a plan to make sure I'm nurturing the different aspects? If not, you need to do that. Because your life is not about one thing. It's about different things. Praise the Lord. Now, here is another question. Do you have a weekly plan for your week? In other words, things that you're going to get done in each week on certain days of the week. How many of us, you know, have that? You don't have to raise your hand. Like, okay, this is what's going to happen. These are the things that I'm going to do this week. And this is going to be on Tuesday. This is going to be on Wednesday. This is going to be on Thursday. Do you have that? If you don't, then how are you living your week? Just whatever comes on Monday, we do it. Whatever comes on Tuesday, we do it. Whatever comes on Wednesday, we do it. That is not the best way to be successful. Praise the Lord. Let me give you some more examples. For example, you know, both men and women here, if you go to do grocery shopping, how many times a week do you go to stores? Some people can go to stores 5 times a week or 4 times a week. Do you know what? If you go to stores so many times a week, it's possibly an indication that you have not planned properly. Because if you have planned properly, you'll be able to sit down and say, this is what I'm going to need for a week or two if you have the money. And this is when I'm going to hit the store. And there's no more store this week. Because that time will be used for something else. Is anybody following me? But every time you're driving, you say, oh, the store is right next to my house. You pop in there. You spend 5 or 10 minutes. 2 days later, oh, I remember we need this. You stop there, you pop in there. How are you going to succeed and thrive in other areas of your life because you use 5% of your time in the week to go to stores? The same store, to buy different things at different times. Am I resonating with anybody? How many times do you stop at gas stations in 1 week? How many times? If you don't plan that, you can stop 2, 3, 4 times in a week. Those are times that you are wasting. And you say, well, I don't have time to read my Bible. I don't have time for family. I don't have time for this and that. God says, well, plan your week. I'm going to go to the gas store twice a week or once a week, and once I fill my tank or whatever, that's it. They are not seeing me there because the time you're driving there, the time you're stopping there, everything is a waste of time because you have not really planned all the things you have to do. Praise the Lord. They may be in simple little things. How many times do you go to the bank or ATM machine in a week? or anytime I need money. You see how many minutes you're wasting? I'm talking about success. If you are going to be successful in different areas of your life, God says, I give you 24 hours in a week, in a day, and you have 7 days in a week. It is your duty to plan every minute of it. I saw something on WhatsApp this week or something. I don't remember all the detail, but it's something to this effect that if you had an account, I'm sure you've seen this before, it's something common, and somebody deposits the same amount of money there every day, and you have to use it up, right? How many of us have seen stuff like that? And whatever you don't use at the close of the day, right, you lose it. So how would you do that? How would you take care of that account? You make sure you use everything up, because they will give you the same quota of money in your account every day, and whatever you don't use, you lose it. The person now says, well, guess what? You already have that account, and that account is time. You have 24 hours in every day. The ones you wasted, you will never get it back tomorrow. So you waste time going to stores 5 times a week, going to gas station 3 times a week, or any gas station you see, you just go there. We do random things. We may not be able to succeed in other areas of our lives. And we keep crying, there is no time, there is no time, there is no time. Praise the Lord. Number two, do you plan for your week? Does your day have a format? These are questions to help me know if I have a life that is planned. Do you have a format of your day? In other words, the routines that you do in your life. Praise the Lord. I want you to just think about it personally. This is what I do. This is what I do. This is what I do. This is typically how my day goes. Let me say something to us. A life without a format or routine cannot be very productive or successful. Did you know that? I'm talking about things very simple. Let me tell you how simple it is. Do you know there are people that don't have bedtime? I'm trying to have a bedtime. Because this is for all of us. Here's what I mean. Today, you sleep at 10. Tomorrow, you sleep at 12. The day after, you sleep at 11. The day after, you sleep at 1 a.m. The day before, you are knocked out at 9:30. If that's your life, your day doesn't have a format and you have no routine. You cannot be as successful as you can. It's a fact. The reason is that when you don't have that, you don't have time slot for everything else. Even if you have, you will not be able to achieve it. Do you know that there are Christians that don't have prayer time? You know why they don't have specific prayer time? Because if they slept late last night, by the time they wake up this morning, it's time to go to work. I said, well, there's no time. They just rush. Some people are just praying maybe on the steering wheel. You know why? Because you slept late last night because yesterday was not planned. So it can cost you spiritually, it can cost you physically, it can cost you in different ways. If you don't have routine in your life. But you know what it takes to get routine in our life? Anybody know? Discipline. Now today, it may look like I'm not preaching, that I'm just educating in practical wisdom. But we need practical wisdom. No, listen, the fact is that the reason many of us are not be able to pray as we should is because our other time is all badly spent. Let me tell you something. A couple of months ago, I heard on the radio, I shared this before, a man, not a pastor. He was being interviewed, and he just said as part of the interview, it was not even the question they asked him, but he was getting to the answer. And he said, I used to pray 2 hours a day from 4:30 to 6:30. That's what he said. And that was just part of his. And you know, at this time, he was managing a big company. I don't know if he was CEO or CFO or whatever. He said, but I was managing, you know, a huge corporate American company. And I thought to myself, if an ordinary church member, I don't know what category he is, but I don't think he was a pastor. I'm right about that, I believe. I said, how come me as a pastor cannot pray for 2 hours a day? Where does he get that time? He said, he's not busy. No, the guy said, I was managing corporate America. Aha. You know why? The reason he's able to pray 2 hours a day is because every other thing is planned and they have their place. You are not managing corporate America, you don't have 30 minutes to pray. You know why? Because your time is not planned. That's why what I'm saying is important. You might say, well, Pastor, I mean, it doesn't look like you're preaching today. It just looks like you're teaching some secular subject. Well, that is how it affects your life. So I had to ask myself, how do I need to plan my life so that me as a pastor can have set time that I can pray every day? If I go to store at 10 p.m. or 11 p.m., how am I going to get up to pray in the morning? If you do that, how are you going to get up to pray in the morning? Because by the time you come home, it's too late. You hit the bed, you wake up 5 minutes before the time you're supposed to get to the shower and leave. There goes your prayer that day, that week. Praise the Lord. If you don't have a routine, it means that your life has no format and you do anything anytime. Do you know that the only area, the only part of many people's life that is organized, guess what? Help me out in this. What do you think is the only area of most people's life that is organized? Their work. Praise God. Why? Because your job will not be shifting their hours. You know you get to work at 9, you leave by 5. The rest of their day is whatever comes is what they do. How are you going to succeed? How many of us have a problem with procrastination? Procrastination is pushing what you're supposed to do till tomorrow. Or at least you know somebody that has a problem with procrastination. You know the problem with procrastination? Here's the problem. Procrastination is partly due to lack of clear and observable planning. Here's how it works. If you don't have planned that this is what is going to happen on Tuesday, and this is what is going to happen on Wednesday or Thursday, guess what? On Sunday, what you're supposed to do, you say, well, I'll do that on Monday. You know why you're going to tell yourself you're going to do it on Monday? Because you haven't filled in anything. For what? For Monday. So, but if everything is planned and you know that, look, I cannot do that on Monday because there's something on Monday, guess what? I'm going to have to do it today. So what I'm saying is that even when we don't know it, lack of planning causes us to procrastinate. Hello? Why? Because you can only see today. But the one that says, okay, wait a minute, let me look at what Monday and Friday looks like, we'll be able to say, that thing, if I can't get it done today, it's not going to be done this week because everything is filled. If you're having a problem with procrastination, maybe 80% of that reason is you don't have a plan for your day, you don't have a plan for your week. Success cannot come that easily. Praise the Lord. So, not only our week, maybe like a short-term planning, we should even have a medium-term planning. Where do you want to be spiritually at the end of 2017? Do you know there are people that have never thought about that? How are you going to get there if you've never thought about it? No, it's just a question. Accidentally, it's not going to work. Personally, your business, family, if you don't have plan, how are you going to arrive there? So what I want to encourage us is, what we need to do is, if you want to be a successful man or a successful woman to the degree that is you are capable of, God says we should take a lesson from the ant, the plan. Let's simplify it. Start by planning your day. Your day. Get a piece of paper. Praise God. Write out the activities you are going to do tomorrow. Amen? Is that hard? It's not. How many of us do that here? How many of us do that? Get a piece of paper. Are you listening to me? This is very simple. Write out what you are going to do tomorrow. Then tomorrow at night, write out what you are going to do the day after. Before you know it, you can get to a point whereby you can have what you're going to do for a week. you will realize that you can get a lot done and you can begin to take care of areas that you have been neglecting. Because all of a sudden now, everything has its place. It's a simple thing to do, but it takes discipline to do it. Let me give you one illustration of why it takes discipline. Let's say tonight. I don't know, they have some kind of show on the new president or whatever. And it's so interesting. And you start watching. You're supposed to go to bed at 10. You watch that program until 11. By the time you leave the TV to get to bed, your eyes are completely closed. When are you going to write the thing for tomorrow? It's not possible. Maybe in your dreams. But it takes discipline to say, you know what? I need to cut off this TV right now because I need a few minutes before I sleep to plan tomorrow. It takes discipline. Praise the Lord. Amen. So, to be successful, it's not just prayer. Otherwise, you can be very successful in one area of your life and everything else can be mediocre. You can be successful at your career if that's all you put your time, but your family life may not be successful. Your spiritual life may be dead. And it's not because you don't want to, but the only thing organized in your life is your job. Everything else has no place. Success may not come in. The last thing I want to say, even in our time is well spent, I'm going to move very fast on this. Another element of success is diligence. Diligence and good work ethics. Let's see how fast we can go on this. Diligence is defined as constant and earnest effort. Constant and sincere effort, right? To accomplish what you have undertaken. Or maybe you can say persistent work, persistent exertion of energy so you can achieve something. You could say diligence is thoroughness, being thorough, being careful, being hardworking. The opposite of it would be what? Slothfulness and laziness. Do you know there are many people that want to be successful, but they are lazy? Amen? Right? When I said we are talking about biblical blueprints to success, you think I'm not going to be very practical? Amen. Because you cannot. It's not just pray that, Lord, make me succeed. God said, well, are you doing what you're supposed to do? Here is a Gallup poll. Worldwide actively disengaged employees outnumber the engaged employees nearly 2-1. Gallup polls find that 13%, between 2001 and 2012, only 13% of employees all over the world, I don't know how they come up with these things, only 13% are actively engaged in their work. Not engaged, 63%. Actively disengaged, 24%. What that means is that 63% of employees that go to work every day, clock in, clock out, they are not engaged, meaning they lack motivation, they lack, you know, effort to put in. They just go in there to get their hours and their paycheck and to get out. And some of us here fall in that category. How are we going to be successful? You know, most employees just work for money. They have no interest in what they are doing. They have no passion. There is no commitment in what they do. They just do the barest minimum to complete their hours and to get out. They have no contribution to the company. How are we going to be successful? We pray. God is not unjust. So, diligence, commitment to what you do, God is going to put that in the factor to promote you. Let me ask you a question. Can you say you are diligent on your job? Are you fully committed to the success of that company? Not just your review at the end of the year. If you're not, you may not be successful. Many employees are lazy. Do you know that? Here's what laziness looks like. They like to while away time. Do you know there are people that when they're on their job, or most of the time, they are on their phones, they are on Facebook, they are chatting away, and they are on somebody's clock. Hello? Don't be offended. And you're asking God to promote you. God says, but I'm looking at you. 50% of your employer's time that he's paying you for, you are on Facebook, you are on internet, you are on the phone. How are you going to be successful? The Bible says, laziness leads to poverty. Diligence, the hand of the diligent will bear rule. That's what it says. Promotion and success, they may not come your way because there is no hard work. There is no commitment to what you do. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 24, this is what it says. The hand of the diligent will rule, but the lazy man will be put to forced labor. Praise the Lord. Proverbs 10, 24, he who has a slack hand becomes poor, but the hand of the diligent makes rich. The hand of the hardworking. Are you hardworking on your job? You say, it's not my father's business. I just go there to collect paycheck. You may not be successful because God watches. Praise the Lord. There are lots of employees, they do eye service. When the manager is around, they are hardworking. When the boss is around, they are hardworking. When an inspection is going to happen, everywhere is clean. But let those guys turn their back, it's chit-chatting on the job. And you say, God, promote me. God says, you? Where you are already, you are not faithful. Why should I promote you? Amen. Don't be annoyed, though. I'm just telling the truth. Success comes by hard work, diligence, constant effort at your job. God is not a magician. He can answer prayer, but he answers prayers according to principles. Praise the Lord. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 5 to 7. Quickly, here's what it says. Bond servants, be obedient to your masters, to those who are masters according to the flesh, with fear and trembling, in sincerity of heart, as to Christ, not with eye service, as men pleasers, but as bond servants of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. That's what it says. The Bible actually mentions the word eye service. Eye service. Oh, the boss is coming. Oh, they're going to have an inspection tomorrow. Let's make sure we do everything right. Let's take care of this patient because, you know, the doctor is, I can hear his footstep down the hallway. How is God going to promote you? You can pray and waste your prayers because there is no diligence. We're talking about success. Praise the Lord. This year you want to be successful. God says, change your attitude towards the little you have and that you are doing. Be faithful and be diligent. Don't be lazy. Praise the Lord. I used to have some teachers when I was in high school, you know, several years ago. Thank God that's not how all teachers are. Because you know what, when we have their period, we have their subject, they are not around. They are just walking about the street. They are youth coppers then. So some of the subjects, we know zilch because our teachers didn't show up. Praise God. There are some courses I just didn't take because I know the one teaching it. Sometimes when they are supposed to be in our classes, they will be in their staff room talking. It will be the student that will go there and say, ma'am, it's your period. Praise God. Now, you're laughing. What about we healthcare workers? Hello? What do you do with your patients? You are on the clock, but you're at Walmart. Amen? Is it okay if I tell the truth? You are on the clock, but at that time, the GPS location says you are at Walmart. How are you different from the teacher I was talking about? Hello? How is success going to come? God bless me. I pay my tithe. God, yeah, I see. But half of your employer's time, you are doing your business. Praise the Lord. If you are not faithful in someone else's business, how is God going to promote you? Tardiness. There are employers that are so tardy. They get late to work. They have their work, everything that is assigned you is done with mediocre. There's no excitement. There's no excellence in whatever you do. Nothing. How is God going to promote you? Praise the Lord. So what we are talking about, look at examples of tardiness in business. You can put that up on the screen. Let's say you open your own business. Have you been to businesses that they will open their store late? And you're asking God to bless. God said, yeah, you have 10 customers, you cannot open your store on time. When I give you 100, they will line on the street. They don't keep appointments. You know any business individuals? They tell you, I'll be there at 10. You better go and do something else because they won't be there until 2 hours later. I know some of them. So if you are tardy at what you do, you are a caterer. Your food is not done well. You understand? Bad ingredients, you know, cheap ingredients, and you're asking the Lord to expand your business. When I gave you an order, I was like, it's deplorable. How am I going to, refer you to somebody else? And you say, it is the enemy that doesn't want my business to prosper. No, it is your food that doesn't want your business to prosper. Why? Because you are not doing it with excellence. You are not delivering it on time. Amen? Tardiness can affect your success. Are you understanding me? I come back to healthcare workers because I know we have a lot of us. How do you take care of your patient? If your patient have any reason to come back to your facility, would they request for you? If they won't request for you, why should God give you more patients or take you to a place whereby you're going to be overseeing the care of many more patients? Praise the Lord. Are you understanding me? So we need to change our mind. We need to change our attitude towards what we do. The Bible says, not with eye service, but as unto God. Let God find you excellent in what you're doing. Home improvement people, they will never show up on time. They will use cheaper stuff, and the whole thing crumbles afterwards, and they're asking for referrals. And if you ask, they may be an elder in their church. Are you understanding me? God is not a magician. Whatever what field you are in, you have to do it excellently if you want God to bless you. Otherwise, you can be in that same place for a long time. If you have a business place, is it clean? When somebody walks in there, is it attractive? If it's not, why should they come back? Are you understanding me? Do you know how David got to the palace? It was somebody that had seen him perform excellently that recommended him. He said, I know a Jewish boy, a young man, the son of Jesse. And he described him, he's so excellent, he's very good, he even looks good. Saul said, go and bring him. That is how David stepped foot into the palace. That means somebody recommended him because of what they have seen. If a potential investor you don't know were to come around you where you work and you have been praying for blessing, will what they see you do cause them to say, I want to finance you? If not, why should God bless you? And I finish right here. What about at home? Success at home. Wives, if you carelessly prepare food, no taste, nothing, you say, well, it's my husband, he's going to eat it anyway. Well, he's going to eat it because he has no choice. But where is excellence in the food preparation? Do you know that might be affecting the success of your family? Did you know that? Just the food. Well, I don't know why half of the time the food that I prepare is wasted. He just doesn't want to tell you because they don't taste good. Hello? Praise the Lord. Maybe somebody walks there, the house is unkempt, everything, toys are all over the place, the sink is dirty, the bathroom is dirty and everything. You say, well, I go to work 8 hours, he goes to work 8 hours, so let everybody do their own share. That's not excellence. Praise the Lord. Is somebody following what I'm saying? That's not excellent. You say, okay, well, husband, your house is in disrepair. The Bible says through laziness, the house leaks. Do you know that there are husbands, your wife's car is being messed up, and for 6 months, she'll be driving that car like this on the street, and she has a husband. Hello? Yeah. What is the husband doing? Oh, no. Now, I didn't get a response when I talk about the wife. Now, yes. So you are not sleeping. Praise God. No, seriously. Osman, what are you doing? Your car's wife, one part faces north, the bottom faces the south. And he said, well, she should take it to the mechanic. What are you doing? Praise God. Maybe we come to your house, the hot water is not working or something. You know, you say, well, I'm working hard for this house. Show it first in the house. Excellence. Diligence. Praise the Lord. We can be successful. God wants us to be successful, but we have to be partners with God in our success. Planning belongs to you. Then when you pray, God says the prayer, answer of the prayer belongs to me. So, in closing, two things you take away from this message today. Success doesn't just come accidentally. Last week we learned that you have to sharpen your skills if you're going to succeed. Today we learned two things. Your life has to be a well-planned life. Otherwise, everything will be mismanaged. You always run out of time. Some area will always suffer. Number two, we all have to cultivate the habits of diligence and hard work. It may not be easy. It may not be easy, but we have to cultivate it so that, like Daniel, like David, we will excel in whatever we do. And when people describe us, they will say, oh, no, that one, she knows what is doing. I'll recommend her anytime. That's how some of these people made it. Praise the Lord. Let's rise up on our feet. Hallelujah.